This right here is the Hollyland Lark Max, and we're testing out the range. Bailey, take a hike.
I'm gonna talk right now. We're seeing how the range is on this beauty. Wait, that's not the right song.
I think on paper, the two main selling points for the Lark Max are the adaptive frequency hopping, which lets you get significantly more range with less dropouts than some of the competitors. And the second thing is the active noise cancellation. Now, both of these things I don't really care about because I'm pretty much always recording videos direct to the camera really close within like a few meters at most. So dropouts really is never a concern for me. And the second thing with noise cancellation, I tend to not like noise cancellation built into devices like this. I don't like baking it into my files. For people who are doing like run and gun vlogging or street interviews and they just want to upload to social media really quickly, it's gonna be great for them. For me, I tend to prefer doing my own processing later because it's a bit more subtle and a bit more effective, and I just like the tools that I have, so I don't really like baking those effects into my audio files. The two most attractive features for me, number one, the build quality. These are built like a tank. The case feels nice. The travel case that comes with it also feels really good, and the microphones themselves feel stellar, like significantly better than any of the competitors that I've used in the past. And the second thing that impresses me the most is the UI inside the receiver. So I got this set up on my Mixpre 6 right now. The UI is fantastic. They've designed it so intuitively. The menus are so easy to use. No complaints there. I think it's fantastic. Now, before we get into the nitty gritty, these microphones are 2.4 gigahertz spectrum microphones, which means they operate on the Wi-Fi band, which also means that in really densely populated areas, there's gonna be more chances of dropouts. So these are not a professional microphone. These would be considered like prosumer. Before we get into the testing, let's just answer the big question. Should you buy this over the competitors? And then we'll get into the testing. So if you just came here for that answer, you can just watch that and then dip out if you want. After doing all my testing, I think I have an answer for that. And that's if you prefer the quality of the devices, so the physical build quality and the ease of use in the UI, this is by far my top pick. It beats any of the Rode microphones, the Wireless Go, the Wireless Go 2, the Wireless Me, the Wireless Pro. It beats the Comica, it beats the Chemafun. So this is my top pick for build quality and UI. If for what other reason you need other features like 32-bit float, or you really want time coding your devices, I'd recommend the Rode Wireless Pro. In the box, you'll receive an extremely well-built travel zipper case with weather sealing and a carrying strap. Now, the theme you'll notice with this review is that everything is really, really well-built. The build quality on these devices is, I would say, exceptional, and I don't throw that word out there very lightly. These are really, really well-built. Inside, you have a plastic charging case, and it feels really heavy. The texture feels quite nice. Can also be charged via the included USB-C cable, and it'll show the remaining battery on the front with these LED indicators. Inside the top zipper, you'll receive some additional cables for attaching it to things like cameras, smartphones, tablets, or your computer. You'll also receive two clip-on windsocks that will help immensely with wind noise. Inside the case itself, we have our three devices, two wireless transmitter packs and one wireless receiver with this fantastic OLED display on the front. Now, Hollyland was kind enough to send along two lavalier microphones that can be attached to add to these units. So if you want to use this as a belt pack and run a lavalier up your shirt, you can do that as well. These do not come with the device, but we'll test out the sound of these as well in this review so you can see if it's something that you want to pick up as well. Now I'm going to show you the different configurations that you can use with this microphone, and then we'll compare it to two other microphones that I have here sitting on the floor ready to go. So let's jump into the different sound comparisons based on where you put the microphone. For a control, this is using the Hollyland microphone handheld. This is the Hollyland microphone with the added windscreen. This is the Hollyland microphone used on my collar. And this is the Hollyland microphone used with a magnet on my shirt. This here is the additional lavalier that you can buy to go with your device. Now I've added a foam cover to that. This is with the foam cover on the additional lavalier. And this is the Hollyland microphone with the included lavalier taped to my chest with a shirt over top. For a control, this is using the Hollyland microphone handheld. Okay, and right now you're listening to the Comica Boom XD Pro. And finally, this is the microphone from Chemafun. This is the Hollyland microphone with the added windscreen. This is the Comica Boom XD Pro with the included windscreen. This is the wireless microphone from Chemafun with the included windscreen on the top of it. This is the Hollyland microphone used on my collar. This is the Boom XD Pro mounted to my collar. This is the wireless microphone from Chemafun clipped to my collar. This here is the additional lavalier that you can buy to go with your device. This is the included lavalier microphone that comes with the Comica Boom XD Pro. This is Chemafun's included lavalier microphone. And this is the Hollyland microphone with the included lavalier taped to my chest with a shirt over top. And finally, this is the lavalier that comes with the Comma Kaboom XD Pro, taped to my chest underneath my t-shirt. And this is the Chemafun wireless microphone, taped to my chest underneath my t-shirt. Okay, one of my favorite ways to use this microphone is just as its own little field recorder. So I don't even take the wireless receiver out of the box. I just basically grab one of these, press the record button on the side, and I can use it as a field recorder and just sync the footage to the audio later. You can also set the transmitter to automatically record as soon as you pull it out of the box, which is a really handy feature if you want one less thing to think about. But I was thinking, I wonder if the internal recorded sound has less noise than the wireless signal that's sent to the camera. The tip of the tongue, the teeth, the lips. The tip of the tongue, the teeth, the lips. In both of these instances, the active noise cancellation was off, and you can see there's significantly more noise in the wireless signal than there is in the internal recorded signal. And this was the case with both recording into my Mix Pre 6 as well as direct to the camera. Starting with the mics inside of the charging case, you can see that it displays the total battery of each transmitter and the receiver. And in the corner, it'll actually show the remaining battery of the charging case itself. As you take the receiver out, you can see that it switches from battery indicators to gain because now it's ready to be used. Once the transmitters come out, you can see that they pair instantly and they start working immediately. I find this whole interface really intuitive. Let's take a look at a transmitter. On the front, we have a connection indicator LED, and we have some massive Hollyland branding. And I wish they used a little bit of common sense not to put a massive brand logo on the front of this. I'm probably gonna use some Sharpie to get rid of that later on, but I will say I like it better than the Rode Wireless series with the piano black, and it's glossy and it shines and it reflects the light to the camera. It's just I don't know why they chose shiny on those. So this is better, but I'm still gonna get rid of it with Sharpie. We have a 3.5 millimeter lavalier microphone connection, which will let you plug in any 3.5 millimeter lav, a power button, and a pairing slash noise cancellation button. On the back, we have a spring clip, which doubles as a cold shoe mount, and we have a clip-on metal piece that will let you clip to a shirt or attach to anything metal. It's actually super clever. Spinning around, we've got the record button. This will illuminate red when it's recording. Press to start, press to stop, pretty simple. Now the internal recording is awesome. It's probably one of my favorite features of these devices, and you can record 24, 48, up to about 14 hours of recording. I think it's 13.9 hours. On the underside, we have a USB-C port, which can be used for both file transfer and for charging. So this means that you can use it in conjunction with a power bank for some crazy, crazy long record times. And of course, on top, we have an omnidirectional microphone, and the windsock just kind of squeezes right on the top here. Let's move on to the receiver. On the left side, we've got the lock and power button. That's important to mention that the lock function only pertains to the receiver. It does nothing for the transmitters. I wish this is something that they could update with firmware down the road because, if you put this on a bride or something like that, they could bump the record button, they could bump the noise cancellation throughout the day. I'd prefer that you can lock all of these features from the receiver, which would be awesome. So hopefully they can update that down the road. On the back, we have the same cold shoe spring clip that we have on the transmitters. And we have a 3.5 millimeter headphone port for monitoring separate from the camera output. Now, this is huge. This means that you can mount your receiver to the top of the camera and plug into the camera like you normally would. And now you can monitor your audio from either the receiver or from the camera, which is great because it's always great to check your gain staging at every stage of the process to make sure there's no glitches in your audio and that everything's going as smooth as you would like it to. I will say that the headphone amp didn't have a lot of juice. I plugged in some Apple earbuds and it was barely loud enough to drive those. So you may need to use it in conjunction with some sort of like a headphone amp or something like that, but it's nice to have. We also have a USB-C, which will let you do any sort of digital file transfer to an iPad, tablet, or computer, or you can use it to power, which again, in conjunction with a power bank, you can extend the run times significantly. Welcome to the inside of my wife's vocal booth. So this is a StudioBricks isolation booth, and we're gonna use this today to test the noise floor of these devices. So this booth is a 45 decibel soundproofing solution from the external sound. So it is very quiet in here. I've also turned off the laptop and turned off the ventilation system, so it's eerie quiet inside of here. And what we're gonna do is the Curtis Judd approach to a practical noise floor demonstration. If you haven't seen Curtis's channel, go give him some love. And I hear it's not stealing if you give them credit. So Curtis, thanks for this awesome idea. Basically, the premise of this test is that we record some dialogue and then we record some silence. And then in post, we bring the dialogue up to negative 23 LUFS, which is sort of like a broadcast standard for dialogue loudness. And then we measure the silence section and we wanna see that sitting below around negative 60 dBFS. So I'm gonna take this dialogue that I'm using right now and then we're going to record some silence as well.
Okay, so I have the audio file here inside of Isotope RX, and you can see I've already normalized this so that the integrated loudness is negative 23 LUFS. Now, if we take a section of this silence, we want to see this sitting below about negative 60 total RMS level, and we can see it's about negative 51, so that would be inadequate or too much noise. Now, if we take a look at the spectrum here, you can see that a lot of this noise is actually coming from the low end, which we're going to be cutting out anyways in most cases. So just for the sake of the experiment here, let's take a look at what happens if we do that. So let's go ahead and add an EQ, and I'm going to set a high pass filter at around 110 hertz, and I'm going to render this on the entire audio file. So now let's take a piece of this silence here, and you can see on this spectrum just how much of that low end is gone, and let's take a look at our waveform stats one more time here. And now we're sitting at negative 69, which is actually quite exceptional. We can take this one step further too, and we can jump into something like a voice denoise. And I'm gonna use this to learn this noise profile here and render. Now you can see if we look at the whole file here, we're still sitting at an integrated loudness of about negative 23 LUFS, which is great. And if we take a look at this silent section, now our total RMS is set negative 75, which is just great. And let's take a listen to this to make sure it's not too artifacty.
Basically, the premise of this test is that we record some dialogue and then we record some silence. And then in post, we're using right now, and then we're going to record some silence as well.
So definitely usable, but a little bit of a drag that you have to do these additional steps.
This brings us to the touchscreen dials, and I'm not going to go through everything here, but let's just cover some of the basics. If you press the right button, that'll bring you to the controls for each transmitter. So if you want to access each transmitter separately, just press this right button and then you can change settings on each device. Now from the receiver, you can toggle on active noise cancellation, you can mute the microphone and start and stop recording remotely, which is really awesome. Pressing in the menu button will bring up the settings with a ton of additional options. We have the three different record modes, so stereo, mono, and safety, which is becoming more and more popular on just about all of the devices these days. Next, we have the mic settings where you can set the gain for each microphone, and I really love having the control for this at the receiver. I think it's much better than having it on the transmitter itself. When I have this wired up on a Bride or on a Talent, I don't want to have to go digging through their suit to fiddle with things midday. If they get a little bit loud or something, you know, they get a little bit excited on set, I want to be able to dial those levels back from where I am, not from where they are. It just seems to make way more sense. Now the gain is totally adjustable by 10 up and down. I don't know what 10 means. Is it 10 dB? Is it 10 fairy dust? I don't know. I wish that they would say whether it's dB or whether it's just like an increment of 10 up and down, whatever it may be. It's like a toaster. Is it minutes? Is it burntness? Who knows? I think it's minutes, but anyways, one annoyance with this is that as you're adjusting that level, it doesn't show a meter, so you kind of have to adjust it and then go back to the menu to see the meters to see if your adjustment was adequate to get rid of like the clipping, or if you want to bring someone up, you have to kind of go back and forth, which I wish they had a live meter as you're bringing up the gain. It would just make a whole lot more sense. Next, we have an auto record function, which basically sets the units to start recording the second you pull them out of the box, which may save your butt someday. We have an LED brightness setting, which will change the brightness on the lavs. You can't turn them off though. I wish there was an off. There's just high and low. It'd be nice to have an off as well. And finally, we have storage, which means you can format your cards. You can also see how much space is left. And on that note, it's important to mention that this is not removable memory. That is so hard to say every time. There's no SD card or micro SD card. This is built-in memory into these devices. Now, if we go back a level, we have some additional things here. We have phone speaker, which I have no idea what that actually is. We have global EQ settings, which I just leave these on hi-fi all the time. It just seems to sound the best. Again, I tend to avoid digital processing in these devices. I would rather do that in post later on. And in the system settings here, we've got all sorts of things: pairing, LCD, upgrade mode, date and time, firmware, all that good stuff. Overall, a very functional and very intuitive menu that is like leaps and bounds beyond the Rode series. I find those menus are just trash. I have no idea how to use them. Every time I use one, I'm just like confused where I am in the menu. Now, in my testing, the travel case can power all three devices in just under about 2 hours, and it can charge them up about 2 times before it needs to be charged up again itself. Overall, I'm very impressed with this microphone. I think the sound quality is better than all of the competitors. The UI on this has me sold, and the sound quality has me sold. The additional features, 32-bit float, I don't need it. I'm recording dialogue. Like, you don't need 32-bit float for dialogue unless you're really incapable of setting your levels. I hate to say it, maybe great for someone who has so much on the go, like maybe they have like 4 cameras and 10 people and they just want 32-bit float to just not think about things. If you take 2 seconds to set your levels, you don't need 32-bit float, I promise you. Every TV show you've ever watched has been recorded with 24-bit, so you don't really need 32. That's a hot take. I'm sure some of you are gonna hate that I'm saying that, because 32-bit's like everyone's like, oh, 32-bit, it's crazy. It's an absorbent amount of dynamic range that you